Nisambula Vinaka and welcome to Tagata Pasifika. On tonight's show, we celebrate Fijian Language Week.
A poem does something with language that you don't ordinarily do.
We're at our first Pacific Islands gay wedding.
I don't think I've been the best brother, but I've tried to be the best brother, and I'm really proud of him.
And a rising star in Aussie rules.
St Kilda, they had a game on Anzac Day, and I scattered from there.
It's Mental Health Awareness Week, and this year, specific events are being held throughout the Auckland region for the Pacific community. Whakatautua is running three events called Connect Pacific, which aims to raise awareness of mental illness. Marama reports.
Getting together comes naturally for Pacific people. It's what we do well. And while tonight looks like any other Pacific function, this one has a slightly more serious objective.
For us, in terms of raising awareness and destigmatising it, it doesn't need to be a scary thing, it doesn't need to be a negative thing. We can come together in celebration over things like our health, whether it be physical health or mental health.
The 2006 mental health survey showed nearly half of Pacific people had a mental disorder at some stage in their life. And Sepuloni says it's important the stigma of mental health is taken away.
Just as often as we can become physically ill, we can all become mentally ill as well. And we need to recognise that and make sure that we're looking for the signals in our loved ones and taking care of our own mental health also.
When I felt ill, I was just so happy to have my family.
Johnny Angel is one of tonight's guest speakers. He's been the Pacific face for the Like Minds, Like Mind campaign.
I think it's very important for me to share the experience that I went through, and hopefully it'll help someone. If it helps one person, that's great, but if it helps many people, that's terrific.
Angel has the support of his family and friends. Now he's urging other Pacific people to stay connected.
I try to do it alone, but it's impossible. But when you've got your family and your friends and other people on social networks and also the mental health services, being connected with them is so vital to a person becoming well again.
The first Aonga Aumata was set up in 1984. It's a proud history that's been highlighted in a new Samoan language resource.
The book was launched at the annual conference of Samoan early childhood educators, Saasia.
The new book is called O Pelenga o Whanau, Treasuring Children. It's the first book compiled by the Saasia organisation since it started 26 years ago.
Our people are hungry for written material.
The book targets Samoan early childhood education teachers and is written in both Samoan and English. It's hoped to be an Indigenous reference for Samoan knowledge.
The resource is basically a validation of Samoan language and culture. It has a historical part in terms of the Saasia, but also the history of the Samoan Aonga Aumata.
The book will also be a valuable resource for the new Bachelor of Pasifika Education degree at AUT. Dr. Utumapu McBride says while it will help Samoan language teachers, the language needs to be spoken at home.
You know, we can't just rely on our Aonga Aumata alone. As parents and also in our communities, our church communities, have also got to do their bit. But at the end of the day, it always falls back on our parents.
Very cute. And still in Auckland, members of the Pacific Sexual Diversity Network met this week for a workshop on how to make better use of new media.
It's all about how to more effectively push the healthy living message in their own communities. John Utanga reports.
Talking about health issues for lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender communities in the Pacific can often be difficult, but the growth of new media in the region can help spread the word more effectively.
We are trying to find ways on how to use these tools to get our message across, especially in regards to our own LGBT issues, such as human rights, health issues such as HIV and AIDS and STIs, sexual transmitted infections, and a lot of other issues such as our dialogue with our religious leaders and also our traditional gatekeepers.
Except for Papua New Guinea, there is a relatively low prevalence of HIV and AIDS in the Pacific. there are actually more pressing health issues.
We need to take a holistic approach, not only to HIV, but there is also health issues such as diabetes, such as cancer, such as high blood pressure.
And while the focus is on engaging communities, particularly youth, through new media, leaders here acknowledge there's also the Pacific way.
We also need to dialogue in the Pacific model too, which is Talanoa. We need to see face to face on issues. And the whole idea is, okay, let's get what we can from what we've learned here and see if we can combine it. I just don't feel that we need to throw everything out the window.
It's a big week for one of the smallest Pacific communities in New Zealand. This is the first ever Fijian Language Week celebration in Aotearoa.
The theme is Nongu Vosa, Nongu Iao Talei, which means my language, my treasure.
John Pulu joined in the celebrations around the country to see how they're holding on to their national treasures here in Aotearoa.
There's a Fijian invasion at Te Papa Museum. These young Fijians are taking over to learn more about their culture.
Mostly things here I didn't actually know about, and yeah, coming to experience what it was like, it feels so good to understand it even more.
Salam Wan Tambu lives in Wellington, and today she's getting in touch with her motherland.
A poem does something with language that you don't ordinarily do.
On hand to help delve into their cultural heritage is one of Fiji's established poets.
We're hoping with this poetry workshop that we give the participants a sense of agency, a sense of power to create and express themselves through words.
And it didn't take long for the students to give it a go.
My island, Fiji. Nogubanua filled with beautiful people, with their welcoming smile and their welcoming songs. The blue sky and the blue sea fills our land with peace and unity.
We've got a warm up and we've got to move on. Okay, we'll go around one more time. Good, a little bit louder so other people can hear. Yeah, a little step back.
Ninana Walla Walla is bringing a bit of theatre to reconnect these young ones with their roots.
Well, I think that just by handling things that come from your heritage connects you, whether you understand what you're handling or not, by holding things that come from a line of people, using that within theatre, it's a window into a world.
It's this hands-on experience that's attracted Eli Tianaviva to some of Fiji's treasures.
Yeah, I thought Omasi is just a design for us just to show where we are from, but it's just more than that. It's like a story behind it. So yeah, I'm pretty proud to know that it's more than just a Omasi. So yeah.
It's now time for our students to take what they've learnt today and put it on stage. But away from the stage, it's here in church that's helping resurrect the Fijian language and traditions. Kolinio Wata fears he may lose his native tongue since migrating to New Zealand. His religion is what's kept his language alive.
If I go to a normal church, there's like different kind of nationalities, so I have to speak English, yeah. So Fijian week, when I come here, so people normally speak Fijian, so it just gives me more practice.
Greg Trail hopes the young people today will preserve their cultural treasures for the next generation.
Most of our New Zealand born here, they all say they know they're Fijian, but they say they're Kiwi. And they don't want to learn the language, but we're having all this is making a platform to learn and just know where they come from.
And if you want to join in the Fiji Language Week celebrations around the country, hop onto our website for more details.
And lastly, congratulations to the Whono of Tokelau, who've been presented with their own badge or emblem from the Royal College of Arms in London. Presented by the Governor-General to Whono members in Wellington on Monday, the badge depicts the Royal Crown, a white cross, and the Tuluma, a carved wooden fisherman's tackle box, which is the national symbol of Tokelau.
Up next, our first Pacific gay wedding. Ralph and Will tie the knot.
Ralph and Will, I declare you to be lawfully married and pronounce you Mr. Ralph and Mr. William Tongia Malesi. You may seal your marriage with a kiss.
Welcome back to Tagata Pasifika. A Pacific Island man's dream to marry his partner of 4 years became a reality in the weekend when the two were announced husband and husband in a ceremony in the Wairarapa.
Now living in Australia, Ralph Tongia Morlesi travelled home for a special day and became the first gay Pacific Islander to legally marry in New Zealand. Sena for lover Sanele Chadwick was at the wedding.
Okay, now I'm nervous. Is it really 1:45?
Ralph Tongia Morlesi never thought this day would come because up until a few months ago, same-sex marriage in New Zealand wasn't legal.
My brother Ben.
This is my son Benjamin.
I'm a mixture of feelings, I guess excitement.
Emotional, of course.
Emotional, because this day wouldn't be possible without the passing of the Marriage Equality Bill in Parliament earlier this year.
I felt so overwhelmed because you don't expect these kind of things. You never know. You just don't know.
Being a gay Pacific Islander isn't easy because it's not generally accepted by the wider community. Ralph's own brother Ben was one of those who struggled at first to understand his brother's sexuality.
I don't think I've been the best brother, but I've tried to be the best brother, and it's taken me a long time, and I'm here to support my brother, and you know, it's not an easy thing to do. But at the end of the day, it's his blood, and I'm really proud of him.
Ralph, what does it mean to you to have your family here?
I wouldn't do anything without my family, so it's not a question or a choice on whether having them here or not.
Yeah, when I come and talk to me, I really hard. It's not easy because, you know, in the future, you can see your son, you want to marry and have a kids, and it's all sort of thing like that. And I think the more I go to the church and talk to a lot of people in the Christian life, the more I understand.
Did you see my mother? Is she
out here? She's amazing,
isn't she? Oh, really? What did she say?
Oh, I think
she's getting a bit emotional now.
When we give him the answer, when we say yes, he was so happy, but we were in tears. Because this is the first time we accept such a thing because we are Christian.
Once I spoke with my parents, once it was okay with them, I didn't care about anyone else.
It's not all a family agree. That's own choice or coming or not. And I think it's good for our Pacific Island too, because I know sometimes a lot of our people leave them alone. I don't want to grow up lonely by himself.
Thank you. I guess through all the years of being gay Polynesian, you don't think of gay marriage. Now that we can have this experience, now I understand how overwhelming it is for a bride and groom. And now we can say two grooms, and now we can say two brides.
Walking down this path is a major step for Fa'afiu Morlesi. She's Samoan, a staunch Christian. And now she's walking her gay son down the aisle. This very public acceptance of gay Pacific marriage is very unusual in island culture, and it's brave. But if there's one thing Fa'afiu's learned from going to church, it's love thy neighbour.
All I do is to give him love and all the best. So he's happy, we're happy, and that's the main thing to us parents. I know it's pretty hard, but we leave those things at the back of our minds, but we leave all the judgment to God, and we've been praying and ask God, with us parents doing the right decision for him. And I think this is the answer. I'm giving him to you with all of my heart. And if you don't want him one day, I will want you to bring Ralph in my arms. Thank you.
Today I give my love to you in marriage with all my heart in front of our friends and family.
With the blessing of his friends and most importantly his parents, Ralph and Will's future as a legally married couple is sealed in the traditional way.
Ralph and Will, I declare you to be lawfully married and pronounce you Mr. Ralph and Mr. William Tongia Morlesi. You may seal your marriage with a kiss.
And just like that, Samoan Utafa and Fa'afiu's son is a married man.
What makes it even more emotional is that heterosexuals have done this for such a long time. You never think that you'd get to have an experience like this, depending on your gender. I just hope that this does educate those conservative Samoans and Pacific Islanders and Māori people out there. Let's hope this naturally progresses through people.
With the ceremony now over, it's time for Ralph and Will to continue their day of celebration at their reception.
Look at these people, they look amazing.
Even the traditional Siva Samoa, normally performed by a female, has a place at Ralph and Will's wedding.
Did you ever think this moment would happen? You two would be married?
Not this soon. It's a shame it hasn't happened in Australia yet, but that's why we come over here.
New Zealand is only the 13th country in the world to allow same-sex couples to marry. Ralph and Will hope other gay couples wanting to get married will follow in their footsteps.
Nobody wants to do something first, so the more it happens, the more people will just fall into it. It's like anything else, nobody wants to be the first one to do it, so now that it's done, hopefully other people will follow.
But tonight's about Ralph and Will, their special day, the day they thought would never happen. Their first dance, their first kiss, even the cutting of their own wedding cake. Moments that were impossible only a few months ago.
Oh, beautiful. Congratulations to Ralph and Will. And also a big thanks to Mum for sharing your son's special day with us as well.
Congratulations, guys. Coming up after the break, we've produced rugby, rugby league, even American football. Now we can add Aussie rules players to the list.
It's massive, really, to get a foot in the door of an AFL club. And for his future, it's a big thing.
Welcome back to Tagata Pasifika. New Zealand has provided a number of players to the Australian Football League, and following in their footsteps is Samoan Tokelauan Joseph Baker-Thomas.
The 17-year-old is heading in the right direction. He became the first Kiwi to receive a rookie scholarship from the St Kilda Saints despite being new to Aussie rules. Karima Fai'ai has more.
It's one of the all-time classics against two great teams.
It's one of the biggest sports in Australia, attracting over 8 million viewers this year. But on this side of the ditch, Aussie Rules has a visibly smaller following, but certainly a fierce one. It's increasingly becoming a hunting ground for AFL scouts. That's how Joseph Baker-Thomas jumped his way to the top league.
Joseph's got some very athletic abilities. He's got some exceptional height for his age. Speed and endurance is another thing. And, you know, his toughness, you know, the toughness at the ball, his courage to get the ball, and also the vertical leap is just a massive part of AFL football these days.
Impressing talent scouts earlier this year, Joseph became the first Kiwi to receive the International Rookie Scholarship from the St Kilda Saints. Not bad, considering he only took the sport up this year.
St Kilda, they had a game on Anzac Day against the Sydney Swans, so they had their scouts over and came to our 18th championship. And I was scouted from there. Couldn't believe it. My family, yeah, they were quite shocked. Oh, they just didn't know what to do either. But yeah, it was good.
It's been a fast-paced introduction to the sport for the Wellington schoolboy, but his coach says he's adapting well.
Catch up with Joseph twice a week in Wellington. We look at skills and drills, and we just work on his kicking. Kicking's the art, the key, and getting that right. Teaching him the basics to get over there and have a go.
I went over last holidays to the St Kilda's. Trained with them for about a week. It's been good, quite hard with kicking, getting accuracy, distance, get a lot of injuries.
He's a great kid, he takes it all on board, and he works hard, he listens hard. Yeah, he's really enjoying it, which is great. It makes my job a little bit easier to keep him interested.
Today he's turning out for the New Zealand Hawks in an under-18 match against Victoria. And playing alongside him is his cousin Waylon.
Joe's personality is funny, eh?
He's not shy of saying anything. He's just out there. Playing with Jay, yeah, it's funny, because we know how each other plays. We just like trying to smash each other and stuff. When Jay received the scholarship, yeah, pretty happy for him. He was happy for himself too. He didn't believe it because it was a game that we're not really into back then.
For Joseph, the two-year scholarship's been a life-changing experience as he now eyes a possible career in the AFL.
It's massive, really, to get a foot in the door of an AFL club. And for his future, it's a big thing. And something to look forward to play in a professional league like the AFL.
And all the best, Joe. A very bright future ahead.
Yes. And finally, congratulations to Tongan Bruno Banani, who will represent the Kingdom of Tonga at the Winter Olympics in Russia next year. The first time in history Tonga has been to these games.
The 25-year-old is currently ranked 24th out of the top 61 luges in the world. A remarkable achievement given he's only been in the sport for 4 years. The former rugby player, who changed his name from Fuahea Semi for his German sponsors, had failed to qualify for the last Winter Games, but he's worked hard to make the grade since then. Time now for community notices with the track Diamonds by Lady Six. When money gets a little bit tight, we hold on to what we know, we never lose sight of the little things. It's the little things that make it all worthwhile. They say they do it for the love, not the money, but the living in the sunlight. Rich now, working, got a daddy turned the blind. Sunny days gonna turn to gray. How long will it last? It seems forever. Bring me down dirty weather. Gotta stack. Well, we have hoped you have enjoyed the Real Pacific series. This week, Robert's in Tonga.
Flying in, you look down, you see all these little beautiful atolls. It's completely spectacular. Vival is Tonga's great marine environment. It's awesome to bring sea to here because this is kind of going deep within Tongan culture.
We're gonna go seashell fishing. I have never done this in my life, so please don't laugh at me. This is gonna be one hell of an experience.
Wow, I wanna go there. That's 4 p.m. Saturday on One. Remember, you can catch all our stories and find out what's happening in the community online at tvnz.co.nz. Keyword Tagata Pasifika. On Facebook, just like us. And we're on YouTube as well.
Happy Fiji Day. If you're in Auckland on Saturday, get along to Three Kings Reserve for a day of festivities.
And good luck to all our kids who are taking part in White Sunday this weekend. Have a great week. Nisa Mwode.